Like so many other Christians this morning, we are coming to you fully live online in an effort to help us experience our connectivity to one another in this digital medium. If you're watching on Facebook Live, feel free to share words of welcome, words of peace, words of love as you are participating in our service today. There is a bulletin that was posted before the service. You can use that to follow along. The bulletins are also always posted on the church website. Friends, as everything is in constant flux, we are adapting along the way, but I am extremely proud of our leadership of this church and of the staff who are making every effort to keep us connected with one another. Welcome to worship at First Presbyterian Church. We are glad that you are with us. Let us prepare our hearts and minds to worship God. I know that this might seem strange when you're in the comfort of your own home, in your living room, in your bedroom, wherever you may be this morning, but there's something important in worship that ritual brings. That includes even rituals of standing and singing with us, even in your own space. And so I do invite you in the different parts of the service to be able to stand with us, to join with us, to sing the hymns, to be a part of the service. And so I invite you now to stand as you are able as we receive our call to worship. The call to worship begins from Psalm 122, saying, "I was glad when they said to me, 'Let us go to the house of the Lord.'" Today we gather in living rooms and kitchens, in bedrooms and basements, though we may be alone in person or only with our close families in bedrooms. Today we are connected by the Holy Spirit in this time of worship. Psalm 122 ends, "May they prosper who love you, peace be within your walls, and security within your towers. For the sake of my relatives and friends, I will say, peace be with you. For the sake of the house of the Lord our God, I will seek your good." Friends, come, let us worship God together.
Thank you.
You may be seated. Prayer is one of the most important spiritual practices of the church. In our times of challenge or distress, or in our best days, prayer should be a part of our daily practice. I hope that you will make prayer a part of your daily routine during this challenging moment. Most of us have prayed, but few of us have actually learned how to pray. So during this time, I will be utilizing a type of prayer called ACTS prayer, or ACTS prayer, where the A stands for adoration of God, or simply praising God. The C stands for confession of sins, where the T stands for thanksgiving, share our joys, and the S stands for supplication, where we share our concerns for others. Friends, let us pray. We begin with adoration. God, in the midst of the unknown, we praise you for becoming known to us in your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, there is so much and so many that we are concerned about today. Hear our prayers for those who are suffering from the COVID-19 virus, for those who are isolated in nursing homes and hospitals and their own homes with no family to assist or comfort them. We lift up prayers for the families that have lost loved ones already, and for the leaders at every level who are trying to manage and care for us all. Businesses and churches and laid off workers, we lift up prayers for all who have less accessibility to the basic needs. Lord, hear our Son has taught his disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Oh.
It is our tradition as a church family to share the passing of peace. For the last few Sundays in the sanctuary, we have been unable to do so with full exuberance. But I hope now, today, in your own rooms, in your own places, that you will share the peace with one another. If you happen to be present alone, or if you happen to just keep in mind after the service, the passing of the peace is also a chance to reach out to others. So I hope after worship today, sometime on this Sunday, you might pick up a phone or send out an email, share the peace and the love of God with your neighbors, with your family, with those that you know. The peace of Christ be with you, and also with you. It's appropriate during this time that we would share even a message with our youngest in the world, with our children. And so I want to share this quick message for the children and the kids at heart. First, hear these words from Romans chapter 12, verse 9. Let love be genuine, hate what is evil, hold fast to what is good. My friends, it is helpful, I think, even with a short verse, to stay connected to our faith and the story of Jesus. Things are a bit different right now. Many of our mommies and daddies are home with us. They're working while we are around. School is happening in our homes. Some parts of this are fun. The games we get to play, the cuddles and the hugs that we have with our parents. But some of it's also hard because we're missing our teachers and we're missing our schools and our friends. That can make us sad. That's okay. It's okay to be sad because love is a big enough emotion to hold many different feelings. Love can hold our happiness and our joy and our hugs and our embraces of our parents, and love can hold the sadness of those friends and teachers that we are missing today. We can even say that love holds our frustrations and our anger at times. But what love holds the most is the promise that the people who love us, the people who love you, they will be with you through these changing moments. They will hold you through those big emotions. Love will hold you no matter what else you are feeling. This is the love of a parent. This is the love of family. This is the love also of our God, the love that holds each of us together. Young folks, let us pray together. Lord, help us to love our family in the midst of difference and change. Help us to love our brother or sister and our parent. Help us to share love with grandparents and aunts and uncles and friends through letters and emails and video chats. Help us to keep love in the middle, for love will hold us together. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. As we continue through this season of Lent, we continue to contemplate the imagery of rocks and stones, the imageries, the rocks and stones that are depicted in the Bible. Images of God's steadfast love, but also of humanity's ignorance and foolishness and even violence. Today we look to the latter as we read from John's Gospel. Listen for God's word in John chapter 8, verses 2 through 11. Early in the morning, he came again to the temple. All the people came to him, and he sat down and began to teach them. The scribes and the Pharisees brought a woman who had been caught in adultery, and making her stand before all of them, they said to him, "Teacher, this woman was caught in the very act of committing adultery. Now, in the law of Moses, commanded us to stone such women. Now, what do you say?" They said this to test him so that they might have some charge to bring against him. But Jesus bent down and wrote with his finger on the ground. When they kept on asking him, he straightened up and said to them, let anyone among you who is without sin be the first to throw a stone at her. And then once again he bent down and wrote on the ground. When they heard it, they went away, one by one, beginning with the elders, and Jesus was left alone with the woman standing before him. Jesus straightened up and said to her, "Woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you?" She said, "No, sir." And Jesus said, "Neither do I condemn you. Go your way, and from now on, do not sin again." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. The story begins on what seems to be somewhat of a normal morning during Jesus' time in Jerusalem. He comes into town from the Mount of Olives, and he heads over to the temple, and he sits down, which in that time and location in the world, sitting was a sign that you were about to teach people. And so Jesus sat in that ancient temple in Jerusalem. And the crowd then comes and gathers to listen. It's in this moment, this semi-normal moment in Jesus' life, that the interruption breaks in. Religious leaders drag a woman into his midst and start shouting, "We caught her! We caught her in the very act of adultery! She's guilty!" Moses said she deserves to be stoned. "What do you say?" I imagine these men all have rocks in their hands. And some are even reaching out and wanting to hand Jesus a rock as well. The air is thick with drama and fear and adrenaline. "Come on, Jesus, throw the first stone. Obey the law of the land. Or will you condone this sin? Will you throw out the law? Will you reject your own faith? Jesus, what do you say? Just act now. We're waiting. Here is a stone." Jesus turns his back on the leaders. He kneels down and simply draws his attention to the dust of the road. We don't know what he's drawing, if he's writing some words out, we have not had those recorded, or if he's drawing some picture, or just simply doodling. I like to imagine that Jesus is drawing a picture of the beaches of the Sea of Galilee. You can imagine it, right? A boat, a simple boat on the waters with little waves, a sun up in the sky, the birds in the air. We've all drawn some picture like that. But we don't know. We just know he turns away from the drama. He remains calm. He says, "I will not be caught up in this moment." But the leaders will not have it. "Jesus, we need an answer. We caught her in the act. Surely she must be punished. Surely we're justified in fulfilling the law. Jesus, what is your answer?" Calmly, in his own time, Jesus straightens back up. He turns to these religious leaders and he simply says, "Let anyone among you who is without sin be the first to throw a stone at her." And then he calmly kneels back to the dirt. He continues his drawing. He finishes his picture. The leaders know they cannot claim to be without sin. The crowd steps away from the drama. And after a few moments, all that is left is the woman and Jesus. "Woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you?" She says, "No, sir." And Jesus said, "Neither do I condemn you. Go your way, and from now on, do not sin again. So the woman departs, and I imagine that the piece of art drawn in the dirt remaining there as Jesus leaves too is the only sign of the commotion. There could have been blood, there could have been anger, there could have been violence, there could have been a body, but all that is left is the drawing in the dirt. Think of the power of Jesus' words. Has no one condemned you? Neither do I condemn you. That's a word of grace and mercy for this woman. So spring came a few days ago. Spring is a time of planting and preparing our gardens. Some of us will plant flowers and others will plant vegetables. And this year, I will make sure I plant marigolds. You see, marigolds are not just beautiful little flowers that come in a variety of different colors. They're not only nice to look at, but they also work as a companion flower to the rest of the garden. They attract the positive insects. They attract ladybugs and hoverflies and other positive, helping insects. They also seem to ward off harmful insects that would normally cause damage to the roots. Gardeners suggest that we should plant marigolds all along the borders of our flower beds and in all of the gap spaces of our vegetable gardens. We use them to fill up those spaces, but really add them anywhere that there is extra room. Wherever you plant them, the marigolds will help your garden flourish. Friends, we're living in an interrupted moment. Step back and make sure that we're not contributing to more drama. Sometimes the most important thing we can do is pause to take a deep breath. We can turn off the news for most of the day. We can turn on the music or create some type of art, or we can go out and plant marigolds in the garden. When everything is demanding immediate attention, sometimes we need just to step away and be calm. I hope that you might use these next weeks to build something. Or you might use these next weeks to plant something or to create something. Maybe this is the time that you are being asked to learn something new. Something about outer space, or something about the insects that are in our gardens, or about the cultures of faraway places like Madagascar or Costa Rica. Maybe this is a time where you are able to clean out that home office, or write down those stories about your childhood, or when you served in the military, or when you met the love of your life. Write those stories down and then share them with your loved ones. Schedule your time. Set a routine about healthy eating and healthy habits. Don't just sit and watch TV all day, but schedule a wide arrangement of activities for each part of your day. Read books and listen to them on tape. Work in the garden. Create life. It is not that you should ignore the drama, pretend like it doesn't exist as it unfolds around us, only that we should be careful to recognize that we are contributing, how we are contributing to the story. Will we contribute more drama by taking up the stones of anxiety and fear that leads to anger? Or will we follow our fears and allow them to dictate our actions? Or worse, will we let our lives act as if this is not a serious moment? As if the rules don't apply to us? That we can keep on living and socializing the way that we always have? All of that only contributes to the drama. Instead, take away the stones and find ways to help the garden flourish. Plant the seeds of help. Attract that which will help others flourish. We can do this through our phone calls and our emails. We can do this through video chats and signs of kindness We can keep finding ways to share beauty and let that beauty be seen by others. Don't allow our isolation to cause us to become cold or uncaring. But find ways to support those agencies and groups that matter to you and to the world. When someone around you is acting or speaking out of fear and not faith and science and wisdom, be sure not to amplify that fear. Turn away from that. Let's also not forget how the story ends. In the end, it was just Jesus and the woman. It is only you and he. The only one who is without sin, Jesus. The only one justified to condemn and to throw stones, Jesus speaks to us, saying, I will not condemn you. I will not throw stones. You are forgiven. Now live a changed life. In the end, that is what Jesus wants, is a changed life. That is the gift of mercy and grace. I love you. You are forgiven. Try again. I love you. You are forgiven. Try again. Over and over, this is God's response to our sin and our failures. In the midst of the drama of this time, may we also have the love of Christ in our hearts for ourselves and our neighbors. I love you. You are forgiven. Try again. Let's put down our rocks of drama and of death, and let's plant the flowers of love and forgiveness and partnership that allows all of life to flourish. Thanks be to God for Christ Jesus, the one whose unwavering love holds us even in this moment. So normally, this would be the time where I would invite ushers to come forward, we would grab our plates, and we would pass them around the pews, but the pews are all but empty. And we know that by passing even the tray with the few that are here, that's not going to continue to support the church. We know that in this time of need, that there are those that are still watching that would like to do just that, support the ongoing work and ministries here at First Presbyterian. So during this time, I'm going to shift, instead of asking you to share the gifts, I'm going to shift to the reason we share our gifts, out of a sense of gratitude for how God is working in and with us. So let me share a couple things that I can tell you about this last week, about how the church was a sign of God's grace and how God worked through us. Since before last Sunday, your staff and leadership have been hard at work. Last Sunday, we already had then the first Facebook Live streaming worship service, and within an hour of having that video available online, we had over 200 views. I expect so much more already today. By Monday of this past week, the session of the church already met together through an online Zoom meeting to discuss how we move forward as in worship and as the church. By Tuesday, our tech team was also Zoom meeting, coming together digitally to talk about how we continue to connect with you through this time. And by Wednesday, our elders and deacons were making phone calls to all of the membership in our directory, checking on each of you, making sure you're doing well. By Thursday, a small group of folks helped with Second Harvest to pack food so that it would be ready for distribution within the Muncie community as well. And here we are once again on a Sunday, and here we are sharing with you in this digital way. Each day comes with new changes, but it comes also with new opportunities to serve within those changes, to serve Christ, to serve this community in love and in fellowship. At the end of this service, there will be a reminder of how you can help support the ongoing work of First Presbyterian Church. Your ongoing contributions will help and allow us to keep our staff cared for and allow us to keep connecting to you as Christ's hands and feet in the world. I am grateful for your kindness, for your generosity, and your support and prayers. Please stand even in your home and join in singing that so familiar hymn, the Doxology. Please stand. This day, each day, every day, now and forevermore.